Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern is heading to Nauru shortly for the Pacific Forum and couldn't make it this week, so instead joining us from the Beehive this morning to provide us with the government's point of views on the issues of the day is Finance Minister Grant Robertson. Tēnā koe, Grant.
Oh, kia ora, Jack.
Where's Calvin Davis?
I couldn't tell you this morning. The job got offered to me to do, and when you get asked to do the job by the Prime Minister, you do it.
So he's not in Nauru?
No, as far as I know, he's not.
When Jacinda Ardern is in Nauru, what is she going to do to raise the plight of the refugees in the detention centre there?
Oh, look, I'm sure that's going to be a significant topic of conversation, and there are a number of events planned where she's going to be in a position to raise those issues, not just, I would say, with the Nauru government or the Australian government, but more broadly with other Pacific leaders. And I know that there are discussions going on about who she's going to be able to meet when she's there. New Zealand is committed, as we've said before, to taking 150 refugees from Nauru or Manus Island. That offer remains on the table. We'd like to be able to do that. And I'm sure the Prime Minister will be advancing those discussions while she's there.
Is she likely to upset her Australian counterpart if she makes too much noise?
Oh, well, look, this is an issue on which we've been, you know, making our position clear for some time, and the Australians hold their views, we hold ours. We all need to work together in this region to make sure that we're not only developing the Pacific region, but also looking after those refugees who are on Manus and are on Nauru. We think we've got that moral responsibility, and New Zealand has put the offer on the table, and we stand by it.
It's going to cost more than $80,000 for the Prime Minister to get to Nauru. She's taking a private flight rather than a commercial option. How can she justify that cost?
Well, it's not actually any additional cost to the taxpayer, Jack. This is an aircraft and a crew who would be working anyway. We allocate a certain amount of money to them each year, so it's either this flight or another flight. And the Prime Minister, as everybody knows, has a young baby. Neve's not in a position to go with her. She hasn't had her vaccinations. This is a way of making it work and making sure that New Zealand's Prime Minister is able to be at an important event for us, and I'm pleased that we've been able to do that.
Well, if the crew needs to fly, if we need to fly this plane, why not fly it to Bali to return New Zealand woman Abby Hartley, who's in a serious medical condition there?
Yeah, look, I think, you know, there's two quite different situations here. There's a long-standing policy around whether or not the government pays for people who are in certain medical situations in countries, and that's been a policy of many, many governments. You know, and clearly I've got great sympathy for Abby Hartley and her family, and I'm pleased that there's been able to be a solution there, but that's the long-standing policy that we've had. I don't think this is an apples and apples situation. The Prime Minister is out there doing her job, representing us at a really important event. You know, our relationships with the Pacific are critical. New Zealand is a big player in this region, and I think if the Prime Minister didn't go to a big event like the Pacific Island Forum, she'd probably be criticised for that rather than the cost of actually getting there.
I just wonder if there are humanitarian grounds to make an exception to that long-standing policy. I mean, in one breath we're saying, here we've got a plane and a crew that need to get flying time, and then we have a New Zealand woman in Bali desperate to get home. It seems like a match made in heaven in some respects.
Well, look, I don't know all the details of that, and given the medical conditions, you may well be in a situation where the kind of aircraft it is isn't actually suitable for flying someone. I don't know the answer to that, Jack, but I do know that this has been a long-standing policy, and I know it's difficult for the family, and I've got great sympathy for them. People have stepped up, and that's fantastic that they've done that, but this has been a long-term consistent policy across a number of governments.
I want to talk about your business advisory group. Why did you choose Christopher Luxon?
Oh, look, he's a person who's got great connections right across the business community. It's the nature of his business in New Zealand that he connects with people all around the country and the regions and the cities across different parts of the business community. And he's someone who's been prepared to step up and say that he wants to help. He wants to work with the government to build the bridges with business. He's not going to be the only person on the group. There'll be people from a diverse range of business backgrounds, but he's somebody who's got great connections and a real willingness to work for New Zealand, regardless of who the government is.
But he's not really representative of New Zealand business, is he? I mean, he is the head of Air New Zealand, which is a quasi-monopoly in some respects, and obviously the Crown is the majority owner.
Yeah, look, he's not meant to be representative of New Zealand as such. He's the chair of a group. There'll be a number of other people on that group, but he is somebody with good connections and a good understanding of the overall New Zealand economy, and he's somebody who can bring groups of people together. He's done a good job, in my opinion, at Air New Zealand, but by no means is he meant to represent everybody. We'll have representatives of small businesses, sure, people from different parts of New Zealand on that group as well.
But he's almost representative of no New Zealand business.
Well, no, I don't think that's fair. I mean, Air New Zealand is a global company, a company that's done very well and won various awards and so on under
Christopher's
watch.
The Crown is the majority owner,
though. He's also... Yeah, but I don't really see how that's relevant. He's a very well-respected business person, and I think you saw in the comments that people made in the wake of it that the vast majority of people supported his role because he is respected across the community. He's certainly someone who can bring a group of people together, and you know we're working on the rest of the membership of that group right now, and I can assure you it'll have a diverse range of members.
How long is the investigation into Meka Whaitiri expected to last?
I'm not sure of the exact time there. We obviously all want to see that done as quickly as possible. It's been led by Ministerial Services, which is the branch of government that manages all of the staffing situations in our ministerial offices here. So we want to see that done as quickly as possible. But obviously, it's a question of natural justice. There are various parties involved, and they've all got to have their views heard. So as soon as we can.
But, I mean, can you give us a rough time frame? Are we talking days, hours, weeks?
Oh, look, I think the Prime Minister said within a couple of weeks was what she wanted, was what she said yesterday, and I would certainly hope that that would be possible. But clearly, you know, whenever there's an investigation, you've got to make sure you do it properly, everybody's voices get heard.
Yeah.
I think the Prime Minister's done the right thing here, and we've just got to make sure the investigation is done as quickly and as effectively as possible.
How many voices need to be heard?
Oh, well, I'm not going to get into the details of it, Jack. Clearly, there's been some allegations, and they have to be investigated. It's a matter of natural justice for the parties involved.
But it can't be that.
And
I mean,
so
it can't,
I'm not going
like
to get into that this morning.
It's not like an Agatha Christie thing, right? I mean, like it's not a crazy whodunit. I mean, there are only a few parties you really need to be able to speak to, so surely they'd be able to get that done pretty quickly.
Yeah, absolutely, I agree, and that's exactly what the Prime Minister expressed yesterday, and I agree that we want it done as quickly as we possibly can. I'm not in a position to tell you exactly how many hours, days or weeks that might be, but I know that Ministerial Services are certainly aware of the government's view that this should be done quickly.
Kia ora, Grant. Thanks for your time this morning. That is Finance Minister Grant Robertson.